Chapter 18. Vanikoro. This terrible spectacle was the forerunner of the series of maritime catastrophes that the Nautilus was destined to meet within its route. As long as it went through more frequented waters, we often saw the hulls of shipwrecked vessels that were rotting in the depths, and deeper down, cannons, bullets, anchors, chains, and 1,000 other iron materials eaten up by rust. However, on the 11th of December, we sighted the Pomotu Islands, the old dangerous group of Bougainville, that extend over a space of 500 leagues at east-southeast to west-northwest, from the island Ducey to that of Lazaroff. This group covers an area of 370 leagues and is formed of 60 groups of island, among which the Gambier group is remarkable, over which France exercises sway. These are coral islands, slowly raised but continuous, created by the daily work of polypi. Then this new island will be joined later on to the neighbouring groups, and a fifth continent will stretch from New Zealand and New Caledonia, from thence to the Marquesas. One day, when I was suggesting this theory to Captain Nemo, he replied coldly, "The Earth does not want new continents, but new men." Chance had conducted the Nautilus towards the island of Clermont-Tonnerre, one of the most curious of the group that was discovered in 1822 by Captain Bell of the Minerva. I could study now the madreporal system to which are due the islands in this ocean. Madrepores, which must not be mistaken for corals, have a tissue lined with a calcareous crust, and the modifications of its structure have induced Mr. Milne Edwards, my worthy master, to class them into five sections. The animalcule that the marine polypus secretes live by millions at the bottom of their cells. The calcareous deposits become rocks, reefs, and large and small islands. Here they form a ring surrounding a little island lake that communicates with the sea by means of gaps. There they make barriers of reefs like those on the coasts of New Caledonia and the various Pomaton Islands. In other words, like those at Reunion and at Maurice, they raise fringed reefs, high, straight walls, near which the depth of the ocean is considerable. Some cable lengths off the shores of the island of Clermont, I admired the gigantic work accomplished by these microscopical workers. These walls are specially the work of those madrepores known as milliporas, porites, madrepores, and astraeas. These polypi are found particularly in the rough beds of the sea, near the surface, and consequently it is from the upper part that they begin their operations, in which they bury themselves by degrees with the debris of the secretions that support them. Such is at least Darwin's theory, who thus explains the formation of the atolls. A superior theory, to my mind, to that given of the foundation of the madreporal works, summits of mountains or volcanoes that are submerged some feet below the level of the sea. I could observe closely these curious walls, for perpendicularly they were more than 300 yards deep, and our electric sheets lighted up this calcareous matter brilliantly. Replying to a question Conseil asked me as to the time these colossal barriers took to be raised, I astonished him much by telling him that learned men reckoned it about an eighth of an inch in 100 years. Towards evening, Clermont-Tonnerre was lost in the distance, and the route of the Nautilus was sensibly changed. After having crossed the Tropic of Capricorn in 135 degrees longitude, it sailed west-northwest, making again for the tropical zone. Although the summer sun was very strong, we did not suffer from heat, for at 15 or 20 fathoms below the surface, the temperature did not rise above from 10 to 12 degrees. On the 15th of December we left to the east the bewitching group of the Societies and the graceful Tahiti, Queen of the Pacific. I saw in the morning, some miles to the windward, the elevated summits of the island. These waters furnished our table with excellent fish, mackerel, bonitos, and some varieties of a sea serpent. On the 25th of December, the Nautilus sailed into the midst of the New Hebrides, discovered by Quiros in 1606, and that Bougainville explored in 1768, and to which Cook gave its present name in 1773. This group is composed principally of 9 large islands that form a band of 120 leagues north-north-south to south-southwest, between 15 degrees and 2 degrees south latitude, and 164 degrees and 168 degrees longitude. We passed tolerably near to the island of Oruro, that at noon looked like a mass of green woods, surmounted by a peak of a great height. That day being Christmas Day, Ned Land seemed to regret solely the non-celebration of Christmas, the family fete of which Protestants are so fond. I had not seen Captain Nemo for a week when, on the morning of the 27th, he came into the large drawing room, always seeming as if he'd seen you 5 minutes before. I was busily tracing the route of the Nautilus on the planisphere. The captain came up to me, put his finger on one spot on the chart, and said this single word, Vanikoro. The effect was magical. It was the name of the islands on which Lapérouse had been lost. I rose suddenly. The Nautilus has brought us to Vanikoro? I asked. Yes, Professor, said the captain. And I can visit the celebrated islands where the Boussole and the Astrolabe struck? If you like, Professor. When shall we be there? We are there now. Followed by Captain Nemo, I went up on the platform and greedily scanned the horizon. To the northeast, two volcanic islands emerged of unequal size, surrounded by a coral reef that measured 40 miles in circumference. We were close to Vanikoro, really the one to which Dumont d'Urville gave the name of Isle de la Recherche, and exactly facing the little harbour of Vanu, situated in 16 degrees 4 minutes south latitude and 164 degrees 32 minutes east longitude. The earth seemed covered with verdure from the shore to the summits of the interior, that were crowned by Mount Capago, 476 feet high. The Nautilus, having passed the outer belt of rocks by a narrow strait, found itself among breakers where the sea was from 30 to 40 fathoms deep. Under the verdant shade of some mangroves, I perceived some savages who appeared greatly surprised at our approach. In the long black body moving between wind and water, did they not see some formidable cetacean that they regarded with suspicion? Just then, Captain Nemo asked me what I knew about the wreck of Lapérouse. Only what everyone knows, Captain, I replied. And can you tell me what everyone knows about it? He inquired ironically. Easily. I related to him all that the last works of Dumont d'Urville had made known, works from which the following is a brief account. Lapérouse and his second, Captain de Langle, were sent by Louis XVI in 1785 on a voyage of circumnavigation. They embarked in the corvettes Boussole and the Astrolabe, neither of which were again heard of. In 1791, the French government, justly uneasy as to the fate of these two sloops, manned two large merchantmen, the Recherche and the Espérance, which left Brest the 28th of September under the command of Brunei den Trousseau. 2 months after, they learned from Bowen, commander of the Albemarle, that the debris of shipwrecked vessels had been seen on the coasts of New Georgia. But D'Entrecasteaux, ignoring this communication, rather uncertain besides, directed his course towards the Admiralty Islands, mentioned in a report of Captain Hunter's as being the place where Lapérouse was wrecked. They sought in vain. The Espérance and the Recherche passed before Vanikoro without stopping there, and in fact the voyage was most disastrous, as it cost D'Entrecasteaux his life and those of two of his lieutenants, besides several of his crew. Captain Dillon, a shrewd old Pacific sailor, was the first to find unmistakable traces of the wrecks. On the 15th of May 1824, his vessel, the St. Patrick, passed close to Tikapaya, one of the New Hebrides. There, a Lascar came alongside in a canoe, sold him the handle of a sword in silver that bore the print of characters engraved on the hilt. The Lascar pretended that 6 years before, during a stay at Vanikoro, he had seen two Europeans that belonged to some vessels that had run aground on the reef some years ago. Dillon guessed that he meant Lapérouse, whose disappearance had troubled the whole world. He tried to get on to Vanikoro, where, according to the Lascar, he would find numerous debris of the wreck, but winds and tides prevented him. Dillon returned to Calcutta. There he interested the Asiatic Society and the Indian Company in his discovery. A vessel, to which was given the name of the Recherche, was put at his disposal, and he set out, 23rd of January, 1827, accompanied by a French agent. The Recherche, after touching at several points in the Pacific, cast anchor before Vanikoro, 7th of July, 1827, in that same harbour of Vanu, where the Nautilus was at this time. There it collected numerous relics of the wreck. Iron utensils, anchors, pulley straps, swivel guns, and 18-pound shot, fragments of astronomical instruments, a piece of crown work, and a bronze clock, bearing the inscription Bazin Maffei, the mark of the foundry of the arsenal at Brest about 1785. There could be no further doubt. Dillon, having made all inquiries, stayed in the unlucky place until October. Then he quitted Vanikoro and directed his course towards New Zealand, put into Calcutta on the 7th of April 1828, and returned to France, where he was warmly welcomed by Charles X. But at the same time, without knowing Dillon's movements, Dumont d'Urville had already set out to find the scene of the wreck, and they had learned from a whaler that some medals and the Cross of St. Louis had been found in the hands of some savages of Louisiade and New Caledonia. Dumont d'Urville, commander of the Astrolabe, had then sailed, and 2 months after Dillon had left Vanquero, he put into Hobart Town. There he learned the results of Dillon's inquiries and found that a certain James Hobbs, second lieutenant of the Union of Calcutta, after landing on an island situated at 8 degrees 18 minutes south latitude and 156 degrees 30 minutes east longitude, had been some iron bars and red stuff used by the natives of these parts. Dumont d'Urville, much perplexed and not knowing how to credit the reports of low-class journals, decided to follow Dillon's track. On the 10th of February 1828, the Astrolabe appeared off Tikopia and took as a guide and interpreter a deserter found on the island, made his way to Vanquero, sighted it on the 12th instant, lay among the reefs until the 14th, and not until the 20th did he cast anchor within the barrier in the harbour of Venu. On the 23rd, several officers went round the island and brought back some unimportant trifles. The natives, adopting a system of denials and evasions, refused to take them to the unlucky place. This ambiguous conduct led them to believe that the natives have ill-treated the castaways, and indeed they seemed to fear that Dumont d'Urville had come to avenge La Pérouse and his unfortunate crew. However, on the 26th, appeased by some presents and understanding that they had no reprisals to fear, they led Mr. Jacquard to the scene of the wreck. There, in 3 or 4 fathoms of water between the reefs of Pacu and Vanu, lay anchors, cannons, pigs of lead and iron, embedded in the limy concretions. The large boat and the whaler belonging to the Astrolabe were sent to this place, and not without some difficulty their crews hauled up an anchor weighing 1,800 pounds, a brass gun, some pigs of iron, and 2 copper swivel guns. Dumont d'Urville, questioning the natives, learned too that La Pérouse, after losing both his vessels on the reefs of the island, had constructed a smaller boat, only to be lost a second time, where no one knew. But the French government, fearing that Dumont d'Urville was not acquainted with Dillon's movements, had sent the sloop Bayonnaise, commanded by Le Geron de Tromelin, to Vanikoro, which had been stationed on the west coast of America. The Bayonnaise cast her anchor before Vanikoro some months after the departure of the Astrolabe, but found no new document, but stated that the savages had respected the monument to La Pérouse. That is the substance of what I told Captain Nemo.
So, he said, no one knows where the third vessel perished that was constructed by the castaways on the island of Vanikoro.
No one knows. Captain Nemo said nothing but signed for me to follow him into the large saloon. There Nautilus sank several yards below the waves, and the panels opened. I hastened to the aperture, and under the crustaceans of coral covered with fungi, symphonals, alicons, madrepores, through myriads of charming fish, girelles, glyphistri, pomiphydries, diacopes, and holocenters, I recognized certain debris that the drags had not been able to tear up. Iron stirrups, anchors, cannons, bullets, capstan fittings, the stem of a ship, all objects clearly proving the wreck of some vessel, and now carpeted with living flowers. While I was looking on this desolate scene, Captain Nemo said in a sad voice, Commander La Pérouse set out on 7th December 1785 with his vessels La Boussole and the Astrolabe. He first cast anchor at Botany Bay, visited the Friendly Isles, New Caledonia, then directed his course towards Santa Cruz, and put into Namuka, one of the Hapai group. Then his vessels struck on the unknown reefs of Vanikoro. The Boussole, which went first, ran aground on the southerly coast. The Astrolabe went in to its help and ran aground too. The first vessel was destroyed almost immediately. The second, stranded under wind, resisted some days. The natives made the castaways welcome. They installed themselves in the island and constructed a smaller boat with the debris of the 2 larger ones. Some sailors stayed willingly at Vanquero, the others, weak and ill, set out with La Pérouse. They directed their course towards the Solomon Islands, and there perished with everything, on the westerly coast of the chief island of that group, between Cape Deception and Satisfaction. How do you know that? By this that I found on the spot where was the last wreck. Captain Nemo showed me a tinplate box stamped with the French arms and corroded by the salt water. He opened it, and I saw a bundle of papers, yellow but still readable. They were the instructions of the naval minister to Commander La Perouse, annotated in the margin in Louis XVI's handwriting. "Ah, it is a fine death for a sailor," said Captain Nemo at last. "A coral tomb makes a quiet grave, and I trust that I and my comrades will find no other.